Hello, everyone, and welcome to another edition of This Week in Jewish History. Today we're going to talk about an exceptionally important piece of legislation in the Nazi era, and that is the Nuremberg Race Laws of 1935. The Nuremberg Laws of 1935 were an exceptionally important legislative event in the ultimate unfolding of the Holocaust in Germany. The laws were released in connection with the annual Nazi Party rally, which was held in Nuremberg, hence the name. And these rallies were massive rock star-like events where Hitler could organize these huge demonstrations of German unity and purpose, lots of flag waving, lots of coordinating, synchronized activity that indicated the power and might of the German people. At the 1935 rally, a series of legislative initiatives were launched that ultimately had a very deleterious effect on the survival of the Jews in Europe, among other peoples. Specifically, laws such as the German laws of blood and honor made all kinds of symbolic declarations, like Jews were no longer allowed to fly the German flag and so on. But perhaps more significantly, the Nazis finally determined the "who is a Jew" question. That is, the Nazis were bent on persecuting Jews, but before one does this, one must first identify who is a Jew. And one must recall that in the beginning of the 20th century, relations between Jews and Germans were actually quite positive, and there was a high degree of intermarriage between Germans and Jews. Many Jews had reached very high levels in German society, particularly in the Weimar Republic that immediately preceded the election of the Nazis in the 1930s. And so they really had to identify once and for all who is a Jew so they could focus their efforts at isolating them, hopefully expelling them from their perspective, and ultimately murdering them. So if you look at this chart here, which says in German the Nuremberg Laws, it basically is a graphic demonstration of who is a Jew by Nazi law. Here on the right, you see these two columns here define who is a Jew, or Jude, you can see at the top of the columns. The circles represent, in the top, the Großeltern, or grandparents, and on the right you see there are four black circles representing four Jewish grandparents. That would result in a grandchild that is fully Jewish, four quarters Jewish, and the little dotted line connecting him to a white circle representing an Aryan is specifically indicating that marriage is forbidden. That's what it says right underneath, Ehe verboten. And then on the next column, immediately to the left, you see also a Jew is someone who has three Jewish grandparents. Those are three black circles at the top. One of the Jewish grandparents is married to an Aryan, and this would result in a grandchild who is three-quarters Jewish, who is also considered fully Jewish for the purpose of marriage and not able to marry an Aryan. It should be borne in mind, of course, that the Nazis had no use whatsoever for the halakhic, or Jewish legal definition of a Jew, which is matrilineal. They were concerned only with their racial ideologies, and the Nazis were actually quite enslaved to their own ideologies in this regard. They also characterized several individuals, I mean several thousands of individuals, as Mischlinge, or mixed race. In the column on the right, you see a Mischling of the first degree. That would be someone who had two Jewish grandparents. Either their one parent was completely Jewish, as you see in the small diagram just on the top right, or if both of their pairs of grandparents were intermarried. And then in the middle column, you see the Mischling of the second degree. This is someone who has only one Jewish grandparent, and there were some leniencies, at least initially allowed, for a person who was only one quarter Jewish. And then over on the left, you see finally Deutschblütiger, or German-blooded. And with this chart, the Nazis were able to institute a whole series of measures of persecutions against the Jews. Also in the Nuremberg Laws was the so-called crime of Rassenschande finally placed into law. This is something that Hitler had a very personal paranoia about that refers to relationships between Jews and non-Jews. The term Rassenschande means race shame. And you can see here in this public humiliation of a mixed couple, The Aryan woman on the right is forced to wear a sign in public that says she is certainly the greatest pig because she spends time with Jews. And the man on the right says, I, as a young Jewish man, always, that's underlined, only take Jewish German women into my room. So these two elements were particularly prominent in the Nuremberg laws. It's also worthy to point out that in November of 1915, many of these laws were extended to other non-Jewish people, such as the Roma and Sinti, more colloquially known as the Gypsies, who suffered in a manner commensurate with the Jews, although on a smaller scale because of the population differences, but the thrust of the legislation was equally directed at the Gypsies as well. With the Nuremberg legislation, the Nazis were finally able to really embark on a massive-scale, social-wide network of persecution, such as you see in this slide here. A young boy is sitting on a bench that says, Nur für Arier, only for Aryans. And with this kind of legislation, the Nazis were able to ultimately begin the process of destruction that would result in the Holocaust. Well, that's it. I hope you found this video useful. Please feel free to comment on the website because I'd certainly like to hear from you. And if you found this video instructional or useful, then please forward it to others who you think might benefit from it. Thank you very much.